Hey guys, alright, we are back with Infographics Show, this time Mad Jack, a real life World War II madman. Now, we watched this from Simple History a little bit ago, maybe a month or so ago or more. And I think theirs was shorter than this one. Can't remember, I think it was under 10 minutes though, as Simple History usually does it. This one's 12 minutes long. Let's see if there are any noticeable differences here. Now, Simple History's video was pretty good. And you guys, every time I watch an infographics show, there's at least a few of you that point out that infographics research isn't too good. or that there's better sources to get the same information in roughly the same amount of time. But let's just go ahead and give them the benefit of a doubt and see if they've either gotten better or gotten worse in these different videos.
One rainy day in the mid-1930s, a peculiar young officer smartly paraded up to the front of his platoon's formation and snapped into place with full military precision. Unlike the rest of his platoon, however, this particular officer was carrying an umbrella. Red in the face with anger and dripping wet in rain, the battalion adjutant immediately stormed over and demanded to know what in the blue blazes the officer was thinking carrying an umbrella to formation. Without missing a beat, the young officer simply responded, "Because it's raining, sir." John Malcolm Thorpe Fleming Churchill, or as he would later be known, Mad Jack or Fighting Jack, would be immediately reprimanded for his insubordination and preposterousness. But such reprimands were nothing new for the very bored officer. Amidst the brief interlude of peace between World War I and World War II, Churchill found his military service, well, rather dull. Rare breed of man, practically born to lead others on the battlefield, Churchill itched for excitement and chaos. When life failed to provide any, he sought it out himself. And at a time when roads were mostly non-existent in India, rode his motorcycle over 1,500 miles of the Southeast Asian countryside, often crossing rivers and chasms by pushing his bike along the rails of railroad tracks while he carefully stepped across the crossbeams. To ease his peacetime boredom, Churchill also taught himself how to play the bagpipes, which at the time was not a particularly popular pastime for proper British men. But not one to half-ass anything, Churchill not only learned to play the bagpipes, he would go on to play second in the officers' class of the piping championships at Aldershot, a stunning feat considering he was the only Englishman amongst the 70 or so competitors. Bagpipes mastered, Churchill also took up a keen interest in archery and became such a proficient archer that he would go on to represent England in an international tournament. Churchill may have been a daredevil and an adrenaline junkie, but that didn't mean he disliked comfort. Quite the opposite. Not only would Churchill earn himself a reprimand for bringing an umbrella to military formation in the pouring rain, but he also was chastised for using a hot water bottle to keep warm at night in his cot, against military protocol. To bypass this minor technicality, Churchill instead used a piece of rubber tubing, which he filled with hot water. The regs, after all, forbade the use of hot water bottles, but said nothing about rubber tubes. While most military men measure their alleged toughness by their ability to suffer hardship, Churchill saw no need for such inane displays of machismo, or perhaps he was, as many sources state, bored out of his mind by peace and entertained himself by annoying his senior leadership. Whatever the truth, if anyone thought Churchill was a soft man because he preferred to stay dry in the rain and sleep in warm comfort, they would be sorely mistaken, as the world was about to find out with the outbreak of World War II. In 1939, the German army invaded Poland from one side as the Russians invaded from another. Polish defenders were caught between the two surging armies and quickly surrendered. The hostilities prompted Britain and France to declare war on Germany, and at last, Churchill's long stretch of peacetime boredom came to an end, commenting that, "I was back in my red coat, the country having gotten to a jam in my absence." Churchill left behind his brief peacetime life of modeling and appearing in famous films as an extra to ship out to France. However, upon arriving, Churchill was immediately disappointed. Despite German aggression against the Poles and Britain and France's declaration of war, both nations simply took up positions along the French Maginot Line and did, well, nothing. Troops simply held their ground and generally tried not to be bored for weeks upon weeks, the lack of offensive operations being the result of Britain and France's lack of preparations for war.
Not lack of preparation, let's see if they fix it here.
Historians would end up calling a slight oversight.
They were prepared for war. They prepared for the war so that they could fight it the same way that they won the last war. And that makes sense. If it ain't broke, don't fix it, especially in war. Why would you take the risky bet and invade, whereas you could do the thing that worked the last time against Germany, because Germany does not have the resources to fight a prolonged war, nor do they have the food supply to fight a prolonged war. They don't have the means of production to fight a prolonged war. So if you can hold the line, you're going to win when you're the empires of Britain and France. Calm down. It's just, this is one of the myths, I guess, of World War II, that even though I'm not a World War II historian, I'm not even close to being considered a World War II historian. I really don't know too much about it. I know a decent amount, but mainly stuff that I've learned through these videos, not through reading on my own. This is one of those myths that I'm getting tired of hearing. It makes absolutely no sense. Now, France was a little bit underprepared, but that's because they were overconfident in themselves. But that overconfidence did not mean that they were not entirely they were not underprepared. The Maginot Line was built, and it did its exact job. It was built to funnel the Germans into the Netherlands and Belgium, because that would have been, because then they can put less troops on the Maginot Line and more troops in the northern border to defend. They were not underprepared. The French tanks, even at this time, were better than the German tanks. It's just the French did not update their fighting style, their doctrine, to utilize those tanks to the best of their capabilities. And they also really didn't. The French generals were definitely made mistakes. But I don't think, at least on the British side, I don't agree with the like, for the French, you can definitely argue that they were underprepared. But on the British side, I don't really think you can argue that.
Britain and France had completely failed to fully prepare for conflict, despite years of ratcheting German aggression and a whole lot of angry, tiny mustache chest pounding from Adolf Hitler. Whatever the case, Churchill found himself a victim of Allied unreadiness, a situation which did not suit him at all. There was a war on, damn it, and like a puppy straining on the leash, Churchill wanted his share of it. With the Soviets invading Finland, Churchill joined a volunteer detachment of British soldiers sent to aid Finn forces. They might not be Germans, but fighting anyone who was being an international dick was better than fighting nobody, Churchill supposed. Bidding his comrades adieu, Churchill joined the Finnish detachment. But before the expedition could get all the way to Finland, it was cancelled on account of some sudden and very severe German rudeness across the entire Maginot Line. Finland would have to fend for itself against the Soviets. At last, the proper war was on. Returning to his comrades, Churchill was immediately displeased at the British Army's failure to hold its ground against the overwhelming German blitzkrieg of tens of thousands of infantry, thousands of tanks, and an equal number of fighters and bombers. Churchill and his unit were then ordered to retreat, making for Dunkirk, where rescue awaited overwhelmed British and French forces. And if that rescue failed, the war could come to a very sudden and unpleasant end for the Allies. More than a fair bit annoyed at having to retreat, Churchill decided to creatively reinterpret his orders. And rather than simply fall back en masse, he engaged in an aggressive campaign of guerrilla raids and counterattacks against the German forces, leading small teams of hand-picked men. Churchill would rush, roaring a battle cry into battle, holding aloft a large two-handed sword. Like some anachronistic Highlander, Churchill waded into enemy fire, and on more than one occasion spitted a German soldier on his claymore. Other times, Churchill would discard his rifle in favor of his longbow, sinking barbed shafts into the chests of Germans up to 100 yards away. Rumor has it that during one battle, a German officer asked for a list of casualties and injuries, only to be told that several of the casualties had been shot with arrows. The confused and irate officer warned his junior officer not to joke around with him, only to be shown the bodies with arrows still sticking out of them. Professional soldiers always expect the unexpected in combat, but nobody expected a mad Englishman shooting arrows in the midst of the greatest industrial age war in human history. During a lull in the fighting, Mad Jack Churchill, as he was now known, was spotted by a fellow officer riding his signature motorcycle, longbow on his back, arrows sticking out of packs strapped to his body, and a German officer's cap on the motorcycle's headlamp. As Mad Jack dismounted, the officer noted a streak of blood across his ear and neck, and asked about the fresh injury. Asking for a stiff drink in return, Churchill responded that he and his men had ran into a German machine gun, and his men had screamed for him to run, but he had simply been too tired to. Churchill had thought it simpler to destroy the machine gun nest, even after being shot through the neck. Successfully making it across the channel back to England, Churchill got wind of a new military organization being formed, called the Commandos. The request for volunteers was secretive, but promised aggressive military service, which was more than good enough for Churchill. The progenitors to Britain's modern special forces, commando service included weeks of training in demolitions, firearms, infiltration, and all manner of other topics which Churchill absolutely adored. During commando training, however, Churchill also met a woman whom he would immediately marry and remain happily married to for 55 years until his death.
Nice.
On December 27th, 1941, Churchill had his chance to rejoin the war as the newly formed commandos assaulted the German garrison at Vågsøy in Norway. Tasked with destroying the onshore artillery in preparation for a full-scale assault, Churchill stood in the lead landing craft with bagpipes, belting out the March of the Cameron Men as enemy machine guns strafed the oncoming boats. As soon as the ramps lowered, Churchill waded ashore ahead of his men, holding aloft his sword and, as one soldier put it, uttering warlike cries. A half hour later, Churchill sent out a brief telegraph to headquarters, reading simply, "Molloy Battery and Island captured. Casualties slight. Demolitions in progress. Churchill." Churchill would go on to win several military honors, as well as more battle scars, but his greatest feats of valor would not come until the autumn of 1943, leading the Allied landings at Salerno in Italy. Churchill and his commandos found themselves fighting alongside American Rangers in the town of Marina. Both Churchill's commandos and the American Rangers were not designed to fight and operate as normal line infantry, lacking much of the heavy fire support that normal infantry brings to a fight, such as heavy machine guns and mortars. Armed mostly with rifles and grenades, so that they could remain mobile, the commandos and rangers found themselves at a severe disadvantage as German and Italian heavy infantry assaulted their position in waves. Though casualties were extremely high, the Allied forces beat back every assault. Growing bored of simply waiting for the Germans to come to him to get shot, Churchill decided it would be best to go where they were instead and shoot them there, ignoring the fact that his forces were grossly outnumbered and had no heavy weapons and absolutely zero support. Churchill led a night raid against a heavily defended German position, rushing out from thick undergrowth and shouting, "Commando!" Churchill and his small detachment destroyed the German position and took 136 prisoners. Churchill and one of his corporals, however, had managed to get themselves far ahead of the rest of their unit in the fighting, and suddenly heard the sound of dozens of Germans digging into fighting positions all around them in the nighttime darkness. Never one to waste a good opportunity, Churchill decided that it wouldn't do to march back to friendly lines alone, and instead unsheathed his giant sword and simply walked to the first German position, ordering the men to put their hands up in German. Perhaps thinking themselves visited by the ghost of an ancient medieval man, or simply doubting that even their bullets would touch a man with balls of steel so sturdy, he waded into battle carrying a giant freaking sword. The Germans obliged and were taken prisoner. Churchill, however, wasn't done. He thought it wouldn't do for his German prisoners to be lonely, and thus decided to visit another German position. By the end of the night, Churchill and his corporal took 42 German prisoners, leading them back to the British and American lines at sword point. Churchill would go on to explain to a senior officer that as long as you tell a German loudly and clearly what to do, if you're senior to him, he will cry, "Jawohl!" and get on with it enthusiastically and efficiently, whatever the situation. That's why they make such marvelous soldiers. A few months later, however, Churchill himself would be taken prisoner, surrounded on all sides by Germans and with just six men and himself left alive, and with nothing more than revolvers and a single American carbine between them. Churchill fought on until the ammunition ran out, and a mortar killed three of his other men and wounded another. With nothing left to shoot back with, and apparently separated from his trusty sword, Churchill pulled out his bagpipes and prepared to meet his end, playing "Will Ye No Come Back Again," until a German grenade knocked him unconscious. Churchill would be sent to a POW camp, but was quickly growing bored of not killing Germans. He hastily made an escape. Upon his recapture, he was sent to an even more well-guarded POW camp, only to escape again. Meeting up with a column of American armor, Churchill was rescued, but appalled to hear that the war was nearly over. Returning to his unit, Churchill commented, "There are still nips, aren't there?" and thus Churchill volunteered to ship off to the Pacific. Sadly for Churchill, upon his arrival, the Americans dropped their second nuclear bomb, and the Japanese quickly surrendered. A heartbroken Churchill would go on to say to a friend, "If it hadn't been for those damned Yanks, we could have kept the war going on for another 10 years." Telling another friend that the Japanese had double-crossed him by surrendering, Churchill immediately began to look for an opportunity to join the many brush wars raging in the aftermath of World War II. He got his chance in 1948, when Arab forces tried to drive the Jews from what would become Israel. Present in his full dress uniform at a battalion parade, Churchill got news that a Jewish medical convoy had been ambushed by Arab forces. Not wasting a moment, Churchill immediately rushed to their aid, still wearing full dress uniform. Boldly rushing down the middle of the road and into the teeth of the battle, Churchill commented later that, "I grinned like mad from side to side, as people are less likely to shoot you if you smile at them." Churchill would go on to rescue 700 Jewish civilians and earn greater military honors for his deeds. At the end of the hostilities, Churchill then went to teach at various military schools, ending his career while serving as an instructor at the Land Air Warfare School in Australia. Giving up on its many attempts to kill him, life would let Churchill live out his days happily next to his wife until his peaceful death in 1996, leaving behind an extraordinary legacy of courage and, well, no small amount of lunacy.
He's remembered
for his signature claymore, which he waded into battle with. Churchill once answered a general awarding him a decoration who asked about the weapon by saying, "In my opinion, sir, any officer who goes into action without his sword is improperly dressed." Was Matt Jack Churchill truly crazy?
He's crazy, and this video is pretty meh. I'm sorry, Infographics. The research here was... I won't say the research here. The writing wasn't my style. I'll put it up to personal taste here. It just wasn't my style. I didn't really enjoy this one too much. But that was Mad Jack, a real-life World War II madman. As I said in the video, I did talk about the problems that I was having during the video. That myth of the Allies being unprepared for war. Don't like it. Well, that was this video by Infographics Show. I hope you guys enjoyed. Remember to hit that like button and subscribe for more. And I will see you guys in the next video. Remember to leave a suggestion down below for what you want to see me react to next. Peace.